So it's tend, don't toil. Tend, don't toil. And it's important we understand. I define three words for them at the first service, and I want to start from that place and find those three definitions from Genesis chapter 2. From Genesis chapter 2 and Genesis chapter 3. Genesis 2, 4 and 5. This is the history of the heavens and the earth when they were created. In the day that the Lord God made heaven and earth, before any plant of the field was in the earth, before any herb of the field had grown, for the Lord had not caused it to rain on the earth, there was no man to till the ground. The first word is till. To till means to labor. Such labors as plowing or arrowing of land for raising crops, it means to cultivate. There is a type of labor God wants us to have. It's the labor of cultivating and bringing things to be. Land. That's God's plan for man. By the time you get to Genesis 2 verse 8, God planted a garden eastward in Eden, and he put the man whom he had formed in that garden. And in verse 15, then the Lord God took the man that he had put in the garden of Eden to tend and to keep it. The second word there is recognized there is the word tend. To tend means to look after, to watch over, to care for something. So God put man in the garden to tend. God planted the garden. God put man to tend the garden. And in Genesis chapter 3, verse 17 to 19, after the fall, then he said then to Adam, he said, that is God, because you have eaten the voice of your wife, you have eaten from the tree which I commanded you, saying you shall not eat, cursed is the ground for your sake. In toil, you see the other word, toil, you shall eat of it all the days of your life. Both thorns and thistles shall bring forth for you. You shall eat the apple of the field. In the sweat of your face you shall eat bread, till you return to the ground, for out of which you were taken. For thus you are, to thus you shall return. There's so much in these things that. But you see the third word, toil, and the word toil came after the fall. Toil means hard and continuous work, exhausting labor or effort. So God wanted man to tend, that is to look after, to watch over, to care, to cultivate, not to toil. That's what we've been looking at today. Tend, don't toil. Tell your neighbor, say, tend, don't toil. Hebrews 11, verse 1, verse 3. By faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen were not made of the things which are visible. If something is used to make something, that thing existed before what is made. For example, you have to have wheat to have bread. Because it is in the mixture of wheat and some other things that you can have bread. So what the Bible is saying clearly for us is that the things which are invisible existed before the things which are visible. And if I ask you today, what is the worth of an architect in building compared to what do you call them? The bricklayer or the builder. Sometimes the architect will charge, and sometimes you ask, what is it? What is this? We just draw dimensions, measuring. We tell you this can fit here, this can fit here. It's what the architect actually sees in the invisible that the builder builds in the visible. But if you live in a part of the world like our own type of world, the builder seems to be more interested, more important than what? Have you ever seen some people say, especially if you came from the town where I grew up from, they used to fight for land a lot in that town, and from building, they used to have something they call it to watch over. My father had one building, and he had three rooms. You'll be looking at them. The buildings have no design. By the time you even see them, by the time they've wasted money, it will be glaring that something was wrong from the ideation. You understand? Because they don't understand. And many a times in life too, we have a way of interacting with what is tangible, what is seen, and we think that sometimes they are more important than what is invisible. But the Bible says by faith we understand that the things which, that the world was framed by the word of God, so that the things which are seen are not made from the things which are visible. That leads us to Psalm 127 verse 1 and 2, where the Bible told us that as powerful as builders can be, unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. If they are building it, where then is God doing his own building? We see the people who build the house. Where is God taking the right of building? Unless the Lord builds the house, they labor in vain who build it. Unless the Lord guards the city, the watchman stays awake in vain. Those are the people we can connect with. We see the watchmen. But the Bible says there is another person in the invisible who watches, who guards the city. There is another person in the invisible who builds the house. And the Bible is telling us that except that person is building, whatsoever is happening in the physical is going to fall apart. It is like the parable of the architect. The problem of life is that that God that builds, we don't see. But those that labor, we see. That God that guards the city, we don't see. But the watchmen, they are more temples. So if I tell you travel, God is with you, say amen. But when I tell you, I want more temple temple, I want junction here. How do you feel? You feel more secure. Because in the way of man, we are so drawn to what is seen, but we miss a lot. Because the scriptures told us that by faith we understand that the things which are visible were actually framed from that which is invisible. Which means to have a full comprehension of what God is doing in your life, there must be an understanding of that which is invisible. And unless the Lord be. In 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 6 to 9. 1 Corinthians 3, verse 6 to 9. Paul said, I planted, Apollo water, but God gave the increase. So neither is he who plants anything, nor he who waters, but God who gives the increase. Now he who plants and he who waters are one, and everyone will receive his own reward according to his own labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. Now, if you were in the first service, don't answer this. But I said, I plant a pool of water. God gives increase. Where does God come in that equation? Where does God come in that equation? Increase. But you are wrong. How did I know you were wrong? Because in Isaiah chapter 55, verse 10 and 11, Isaiah 55, verse 10 and 11, the Bible told us that it is God that gives seed to the sower.
Before you can say I plant, you can't create a seed. The seed must have existed before you can even be a planter. So even that place where we fit in, that we call ourselves by, and say, I am this, something had been working in the visible before we became a visible manifestation of that thing. Do you get what I'm saying? So the Bible says, as the rain comes down and the snow from heaven, and does not return but water the earth, that it may bring forth God, that it may give seed to the sower and bread to the eater, so shall my word be. It is God that gives seed to the sower. So before Paul can say, I plant, somebody placed something in his hand. In Deuteronomy chapter 11, verse 10 to 12, it shows us the story of the person that waters too. Deuteronomy chapter 11, verse 10 to 12. For the land which you go to possess is not like the land of Egypt, from which you have come, where you sowed your seed and watered it by foot as a vegetable garden. But the land which you cross over to possess is a land of hills and valleys, which drinks water from what? From the rain of heaven. A land for which the Lord your God cares. The eyes of the Lord your God are always on it from the beginning of the year to the end of the year. Somebody say amen.
Amen.
Now before you water, who gave the water?
God.
So everybody that calls himself a planter, a waterer, is just a co-worker with a God. The only personality that is involved at every stage of the process of increase is God himself. We are all co-workers. We come in and exit at one point or the other. It's amazing how many times we think we are in control. Because, let me tell you, from the beginning, he planted the garden. The garden of Eden was not raised by Adam. It was planted by God. With every dimension, with every type of tree there. The ones to be taken and the one that must not be taken. And God only called man to tend the garden, to watch over. We come into certain realizations. We find ourselves in certain things that we never planted. For example, we never planted ourselves in Nigeria. That's obvious. Neither did you choose your brother. Now you hate people and you love your brother. But that brother you love, you know what? You didn't even know where he came from. Somebody, you just woke up into consciousness and they told you that's your younger brother. And because they told you, you believe it. And then you meet some other people on the road and say, they are not mine. I don't know them. And you have just been planted into a system that is even outside of your knowledge. But it's God. And from that point, you began to tend it. You began to look for the good of that person. Because you began to sense a sense of kinship and attachment with one another. And it's his wisdom. But that so minute part that we play is very significant in God. In the book of Psalm 8, verse 1 to 9. Psalm 8, verse 1 to 9. The Bible says, O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth, who have set your glory above the heavens. Out of the mouth of babes and nursing infants, you have ordained strength because of your enemies, that you may silence the enemy, the avenger. When I consider the heavens, who here has been able to speak and determine the number of stars that will shine at night? Said, today is my birthday, so I want it to be a starry night. Starry night. Then you look out as a star appears. Those guys of the religion close to us, they look for the moon. They go back to the new power. But they are, because you cannot determine the new moon, When I consider the heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars, there is no human being that is older than the sun. The sun is older than Adam. Did you notice? And he has not burned out. We, after 70 years, you need to be there. And that be. Who should be the greatest of? Is it the son or us? We play for 19 minutes. I know she shared. Play football for 19 minutes. And they have 30 minutes cooling break. When I consider the heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon, the stars, which you have ordained, what is man? I'm a planter, but who gave you the seed? Do you know where seed came from? What is man? That you are mindful of him, and the son of man that you visited him. You visit him, yes? You have made him a little lower than the angels, and you have crowned him with honor and glory, with glory and honor. You have made him to have dominion over the works of your hand. You have put all things under his feet. Yeah. All sheep, oxen, even the beasts of the field, the birds of the air, the fish of the sea, that pass through the paths of the sea. O Lord, our Lord, how excellent is your name in all the earth. There is no animal that man has not tamed. Some of them, as small as they have toxins that can kill 1,000 men. I will make them pets. What is man? When a lion sees a man, who should run? We don't have claws, we have nothing. But we can shoot a gun. What is man? Now, man could look so insignificant, but yet God crowned him. Do you know why? Because God planted a garden. God created everything, and God told man to have dominion over everything. That is, the fullness of man cannot be revealed outside of God. Man in himself is limited. Man in himself with toil. So that was why the day man was chased out of the Garden of Eden from the presence of God, God told him, with toil to break the ground. Because from that point, he became his own God. And what? He became his own source. And he started toiling. He left tending and being an overseer of what God has planted. But Paul brought us back to that revelation. He told us that we are God's fellow workers. That is, we are co-workers with God. And the easiest life you are going to live is the life that is attached to what God is doing. When you disconnect from what God is doing, you are going to toil. Most times, we have forgotten that we didn't bring ourselves here. So we try to give the answers for ourselves in everything. That's why we are toiling. Are we together? And forget that we are God's fellow workers. That we plant and what? We water, but it is God that gives the increase. 1 Corinthians chapter 3 verse 9. 1 Corinthians 3 verse 9. We are God's fellow workers. You are God's field. You are God's building. Someone say, we are God's fellow workers. 2 Corinthians 6 verse 1. 2 Corinthians 6 verse 1. We then, as workers together with him, also plead with you not to receive the grace of God in vain. We are workers together with him. My prayer for all of us today is that we will find what God is working. Yeah. and partner with him.
Amen.
That's when you are tending. When you are not partnering with God, you are toiling. See, I was showing them in the first service. Man went out of the garden, and God said, a man discovered that everything that he has been enjoying came from what? From the ground. The trees were from the ground. So what did he go back to? He went back to what? The ground. And the thing, I know how this thing works. He forgot that what he saw was planted by God, not by himself. So when he began to break the ground to revive what he lost, he brought forth thorns. Because it is not man's labor. If man's labor only worked because God planted something, that man is tending. Are we together? Or else labor becomes a crisis. There are so many people that their jobs have become a curse. They are trapped in it, it's not bringing fulfillment, yet they can't leave it. That's not God's design. God wants you to tend, not to toil. Immediately your life and all the things you are doing is becoming a toil, a sweat. Something is missing. There are times you go to some places and you feel odd being there. They are even paying you, but you feel odd because it's costing you, you are choked. It's costing you much more than it's giving to you. You are not tending, you're toiling. We then, as workers, together with God, glory be to God. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 18 to 20, 2 Corinthians 5, 18 to 20. Now all things are of God, who has reconciled us to himself through Jesus Christ. He has given us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, God was in Christ, reconciling the world to himself. Somebody say, God is doing something. Not imputing their trespasses to them, but and he has committed to us the word of reconciliation, which means we are an extension of what God is doing. It is his yoke that is easy. When the enemy disconnects you from the garden that the Lord has planted, it brings you a heavy yoke. I don't know how many people are living and striving and laboring, but they are not fulfilled, and it is even costing them. And we are beginning to live like it is the normal life. It's not the normal life. It's not that. That's not God's plan. God's plan is that when you find yourself in his way, the way of the Lord is strength to the righteous. Even when you are laboring, that way is in itself is ever renewing. It is when you find yourself in the will and purpose of God for your life, you will be laboring, but it's tilling the ground. It's not toiling. You know that you are planted. There is a seed. There is an harvest in your sight. You know that there is going to be what? A reward. You are not living in a nation where you give 35 years to active service and looking into the future with blankness and everything is blank and you know nothing is coming out of it. That's not tilling. That's toiling. That's a design of Satan. Are we together, church?
Yes, sir.
That's a design of Satan. God is reconciling his world to himself. He has committed to us the word of reconciliation. The Bible told us we are ambassadors of Christ. Somebody say, I'm an ambassador of Christ. Somebody say, I'm walking with the Lord. In Philippians 2, verse 12 and 13. Philippians chapter 2, verse 12 and 13. The Bible said, therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not only my presence only, but much more in my absence, walk out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who works in you, both to will and to do for his good pleasure. Somebody say, it is God who works in me, both to will. Because if I'm willing outside of him, I'm toiling. And I showed us in this first service the persistent rebellion of man. That even many times when God confronts us, the hardest thing to say is, I want to return back to my father. That when the prodigal son left his father's house, and got into the country where he was and spent all he had. The Bible said there arose a famine. The first step he took was he joined himself to a citizen of that country. Many a times we have discovered we missed it, but the hardest thing to do is to turn back to God. We have a way of trying to forge on even in our rebellion, even when we have discovered it's wrong. Say, what else can I do? I have to go. I have to go. And it is one of the most popular scriptures I learned in my university days. The rebellious will dwell in dry land. Say, the rebellious will dwell in a dry land. The way of a transgressor is hard. Sometimes pain is God's way of calling your attention that you are out of the way. You understand? What did he do? He joined himself to the citizen. And the Bible says, then the citizen sent him to go and be feeding pigs. And instead of swallowing his pride and going back home, he even wanted to be eating what the swine was eating if somebody had given him. Shame was too much. Repentance should be easy, but the enemy can overwhelm you with shame that you don't want to turn back. The day man discovered he was naked, he hid from God, not knowing that when you are naked, that's when you come to God. Because it's only God that covers a naked man. He hid from God. And who eventually clothed him that day? It was the Almighty who clothed him with animal skin. And it was the Almighty who made the preparation for him, like Jesus, like God prepared the body of his son for our redemption. It's God that prepared our covering. But the covering is so shameful that it becomes very hard to turn to God. It's easier to turn to yourself and hide. And what that does is that it makes the journey harder. How many of us have been able to tell ourselves sincerely at some point in our life, I was wrong? It's a very hard statement. Because you are passing judgment for yourself and you know how you feel. And you know what led you to what you did. So what did you do? You will always put those things in the consideration of the judgment you want to pass. And that's why it's easy to judge others and excuse yourself. Repentance has to become a cry from heaven to happen to man. Repent, for the kingdom of God has come. Because left to man, he will always find an excuse for his path. It is God that walks in me, not to me. And to do. The question I want to ask us today is, when last did God walk in you? Most of us have left him behind. He's in his Eden. We are the one what? Toiling our ground, trying to create our world, sweating, toiling. Unless the Lord build the house. I don't have time to show you. You can listen to the first service. I showed them how the Bible says so people labor to feed fire. And I told them, if you take your best shoe at home and put it in fire with a piece of paper, will the fire separate? Will the fire separate this shoe? No, this one. What does fire do? Fire does not distinguish. Your most prized possession, put it in fire, will consume. Put paper. Anything that inflames it, it takes it. Fire never says it's enough. And it does not differentiate. And the Bible believes that you produce labor. It said, these people labor to feed fire. You will not labor in vain. Amen. In the name of Jesus.
Amen.
But the prodigal son came to himself one day and said, I will go to my father. Somebody brought me here. I didn't come here by myself. I will go to him. When I hit the wall, for example, you can marry with a very clear revelation that it is God. And you know that I'm in the will of God. After 3 years, it might not look like that. And everything will look like you made a mistake. But instead of people going back to the word that they receive and the person who gave them word, they begin to what? They begin to crack their brain and begin to say, okay, this is what I did not do. Oh, it's because from Egypt. Oh, this one is from Esau. It concerns me with that. I will go back to my father. That's if you have one. Because most people just have an idol. They think you have a father. I will go to my father. I said, Father, don't take me as your son. First thing I want to your son. And that was where his life changed. And today I'm asking if we can ask for the way to rest. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16. Jeremiah 6, verse 16. There's a way to rest. Thus says the Lord, stand in the ways and see. Ask for the old path, where the good way is, and walk in it. Then you will what? Find the rest. That is when you are out of the way, you are going to be restless. Please, church, restlessness is not of God. Just to live in continued grief and be choking yourself and be putting yourself in continual sorrow. Joy is not having everything. That's not what I'm talking about. Joy is not money. People have used all their health to get well, thinking when money comes. Our former governor, His Excellency, Ajimobi, I watched one of his videos. He said, when I was young, I did everything. Labor to be rich. He said, then when the money came, then his eye telling us, you cannot eat this one, you cannot eat this one, you cannot. That's the story of man. Yeah. So when I finish, I will be in the morning, it will be done in the afternoon. When you are 40, hey, mama, reduce red meat. Yeah. And this way. And that's what you have been laboring that when you get there, these people labor to feed the fire. And that day, when our children make demand, I laugh because they don't understand. Anytime you take my daughter out, if she sees the sign of anything that looks like a supermarket, she will point. She wants to enter. She doesn't have an agenda, but she knows that when she enters, there must be something valuable. So recently, I started sitting down. This toy, no toy after 3 months, until 3 months. She said, yes, but don't please take her out. Because if you take her out, one day she went out, she said she wanted to buy doctors. Then we look for the doctor, then we didn't see that she ended up buying musical instruments. She had to buy something. And they will use the thing to play one. But I've had toys I bought $1,000 destroyed in 1 hour ago. 1 hour. I cannot do anything. Why did I go into that? Ask for the good way so that you will walk in it and you find rest. Somebody say, I will find rest. Don't say it's life. It's not life. You are not sleeping. It's not life. Even your dream, you are calculating. It's not life. You know some people, when they dream, and 75 plus 10. I must tell you. I deliver you today. Yeah. You know me. Even in ministry, some people don't have rest. As if it's their father, it's their house. They can't see the 10 branches. Stand in the way and see. Ask for the old path, where the good way is. Walk in it. You will find what?
Rest.
Rest for your soul. Jeremiah 50 verse 4 to 7. Jeremiah 50 verse 4 to 7. In those days and in that time, says the Lord, The children of Israel shall come, and the children of Judah together with continual weeping, they shall come and seek the Lord their God. Listen, sometimes to find this way, you need to humble yourself. You need to show and cry to God that, God, I don't have any wisdom except the one you have. How many, the Bible describes how Israel will seek God. He said they will seek him with continual weeping. Our cry, the one of the cries of our generation is that we are so full. The reason why most of you make comments on social media about church is because you think you know what church is. Until the day they say, oh yeah, come and do it. Come and show me. Then I see some leaders and I laugh. I'm telling you. When should we meet? 7 a.m. Is it good for everybody? When they say everybody is good for everybody, be sure people are coming late. It's not good for everybody. Some people just say, some people will not talk because there is no plan to be involved. You say, 7 a.m., 9 p.m., because they are not coming. No, I'm there in the open church. I'm there in the open church. I had to call one of our friends here this week. I said, so, it didn't occur to me that church has opened for 1 month. So I wonder. I said, you are here, God will do it so soon. And it's not bad. There's a way God will bless you, you will be afraid. He said, God, I don't have the faith. Bless you, will be joking. He said, they shall ask the way to Zion. With their faces towards him, saying, come, let us join ourselves to the Lord in perpetual covenant that will not be forgotten. My people have been lost sheep. Their shepherds have led them astray. They have turned them away on the mountains. They have gone from mountain to hill. They have forgotten their resting place. All who found them have devoured them. And the adversary said, we have not offended because they have sinned against the Lord, the habitation of justice, the Lord, the hope of their father. They cannot recognize their resting place. Do you know why? In those two scriptures, the Bible mentioned the word. He called it ask. Stop finding counsel in your mind. Just ask. Sometimes wisdom is as accessible as just ask. Instead of us to ask, we will sit down. I begin to conjure. It is because, oh, my sister's life is easier than me. You know, she married a rich man. Go and marry man and see the crisis that is there. There's nobody's life that cannot become a crisis outside of wisdom. Nobody. Born with a silver spoon, voila. Born without it, another one. Which one is not voila? So the founder of that tech company, he was just 20, is it 23 or 24, that they killed this week, that the founder of Uganda. International company, that guy made millions of dollars last year, they dismembered him by his own PA. The Lord will lead you.
Amen.
Is that person not the one? Who will call him a lazy man? Will he not say, my future is secure? And God will be looking at himself, somebody under the bridge whose future was secure than him. That person was just going to, he's going to be pulled out of that place. Am I making sense? It's as simple as ask. But we are so presumptuous to ask. In Isaiah chapter 52, verse 11 and 12. The reason why people toil is because they've taken the steering wheel. Isaiah 52, verse 11 and 12. Are you getting my discourse this week? The Bible says, depart, depart, go out from there. Touch no unclean thing. Go out from the midst of her. You will bear the vessels of the Lord. For you shall not go out by haste, nor by flight. The Lord will go before you, and the God of Israel will be your rear guard. If you ever drive in a convoy, it takes extra skill. It's easier to move in an, as an isolated vehicle than to move in a convoy. Because the sudden break of the person before you
will affect you.
The Bible says you are not permitted to go out except God go before you. The meaning is that there are so many times you are restless to go that they say, wait. Anybody that wants God to lead him will wait. Anybody that wants God to lead him will wait. God is not in a hurry like you are. You can wait on God for 3 days and there's only one word that will come out. Go. But that go
can revolutionize your life.
And all this jumping from place to place will never delight. And I'm serious. And many times you are rushing past what you need, going to what you don't need. You are the one telling God time is going. You have not made time before. Do you make time? Suddenly, how are you reporting to God that time is going? He first asks you, so okay, time is going. How much of it do you still have? Answer me. Every one of us say, time to look, including the people that say have had 70 years to be here. No. But now, they will still be coming to greet you. And at that time they are coming, they will have gray hair. Oh, but that, who told you? That's what God asks Eve. Who told you your time has come? Try feeling the more pains. And deliver them down. How they want to call those ones higher and carry there, I don't know. Because their own, their birthday cannot be the same. Are they true? I'm not telling you story. It's in Nigeria that happened. And he said, the woman was of age. Are they true?
They are siblings.
How they will be explaining to those children when they are older. Actually, a boy in you, 2 weeks, no matter where, those guys will fight, eh? Very difficult. You will not go out by haste. The Lord will go before you, and the Lord will be behind you. Amen. You are just shut up in the midst of a cocoon. That's your journey. He planted a garden. He puts man in the garden to tend it. Man is just. So when I consider the work of your hand, I saw everything. I said, what is man? Man just came somewhere in the midst of that whole equation. And yet he crowns everything. May God bring you to works that he has finished. Some people just want to labor. They are glory. If you have 10 projects, it's not coming. The job that God has finished. You know, that as a man of God, there are some jobs. Some people have been doing for 30 years. Then the day they come to say, Father, receive the glory. Receive your baby. Then they say, church, a lot of them, no pay, no lot of them, no parish. Some people have, they have been sweating. But sincerely, many of them, there are days we've seen miracles in people's lives, we don't even know why God answered us. It's not the type of day he should answer us. And there are days we say, Jala, we are also the Jala. We should be a problem. Ah! If I be a prophet of God, God said you are.
that will not answer. Doesn't mean you are not.
You shall not go out by haste. You shall not go out by haste.
Let me ask you a question. There are some of us that said, if I don't do this thing this year, my life will collapse. You have done it. Where is your life? He did it, God. Oh, I'm married by baby. How many of you discovered that it's when you married that you discovered that there were so many of your mates that were not married? Before, but at that time, everybody married your mind. Everybody, forget it. Then you married. Then all of your friends got next month,
Uti married.
And if it's next month, it will be better. 3 years after, you don't discover some of them are not married. But you have been killing yourself, wounding yourself. Lord, I'm behind schedule. If you have given God time, He would have purified some of these things for us. But when we are overwhelmed with pressure, one of the things that we stop fast is our time with God. God becomes secondary. We begin to run. We begin to labor. We begin to stress ourselves. And many times we just miss Him. Does God still have a place in this laboring world where everything is about running, helter skelter? Does God still have a place? Who is leading us out? This week we are bringing ourselves again to leadings. A lot of things I'm trusting God for. Because God must lead us.
I said God must lead us.
Amen.
Look at this story in 2 Samuel chapter 5, verse 17 to 25. 2 Samuel 5. When King David became king. Now, when the Philistines heard that they have anointed David king over Israel, all the Philistines went up to search for David. David heard of it and went to the stronghold. The Philistines also went and deployed themselves in the valley of Rephaim. So the Lord inquired. So David inquired of the Lord, shall I go against the Philistines? If they come against you, do you need to inquire? Eh? Say, God, I'm not looking for my trouble. They came to me to my trouble. There's no need to inquire. But David was still inquiring. Shall I go? Will you deliver them into my hand? Because going is different from winning. They're not the same thing. And the Lord said to David, go up. I will doubtless deliver the Philistines into your hand. David went to Baal Perazim, defeated them there. He said, the Lord has broken through my enemies like a breakthrough of water. He called the name of the place Baal Perazim. And they left their images there. David and his men carried them away. And the Philistines went up again in the valley of Rephaim. And David inquired of the Lord. I mean, some of us will not inquire. If it is the same enemy, in the same place, and against the same person, and you won the victory of yesterday, do you need to ask again? Talk to me. That's the way of man. David inquired of the Lord, and he said, you shall not go up. God said the first time, you shall not go up. God said the second time, you shall not go up. There are battles God will say to you, arise and contend. And there are some others God will say, you shall not need to fight in this battle. Maybe the reason why we are restless is we mix it up. And the people we should answer, we did not answer. And the people we should keep quiet at, we are talking to. Because we never inquired of the Lord and never learned from His wisdom. Because we went out in haste. So the Lord told the people not go. Circle them around behind them and come up in front of them, in front of the mulberry trees. It shall be when you hear the sound of marching in the top of the mulberry trees, then you will advance quickly, for the Lord will go out before you to strike the Philistines. Verse 25. David did so as the Lord has commanded, and he drove back the Philistines from Geba as far as Gaza. The same situation, two different leaders. The same scripture says, answer a fool according to his own folly, lest he think he's wise. Then he said, Answer not a fool according to his folly, lest you become like him. There are moments where God's focus is you. There are other moments where God's focus is the other party. And you must be so led by God to know what God wants you to do in your time. This is what is called Christianity. The problem with us is that we are too full in our mind. Who still waits to preach? Our churches, our calendars are drawn. What if everybody starts doing it? March is called an April. It's dog on that. What are you doing on Thursday? I don't know. Do you know why it's always timing? I just follow. And I find the rest for my soul. That's why I don't. I'm not sweating. I'm tilling, but I'm not toying. I'm telling you. I'm not going to have sickness without examining the equipment because I don't know about you. I'm just prophesying for myself. Because I'm following. Right. I don't have desires because that's what everybody is. I drive past a place with peace. Without having a sense of I am lesser than people. How often when you drive past the corner, you begin to feel frustrated? How did I go and buy land in there?
Along there.
Calm down. God needs to give you, do you understand? Because many a times, we take our description and rest from people. A little one will become a thousand. Do you know where you are? Do you know what it will become? Those places you are chasing, do you know what they were? There were people they used land to beg in this Akobo years ago. You know, good. Akobo. They are now crying, please Lord, another opportunity.
One point.
God knows what he's doing. You will not labor in vain. But this takes leadership. A Christian is led. We should stop being presumptuous. Going out in haste. And ending in toiling. In Numbers 14 from verse 39. After God told Israel to get into the promised land, and they refused to go. And Moses told them, God is not with you. Then they changed their mind. Look at Numbers 14, 39. Then Moses told them all these words to the children of Israel, and the people mourned greatly. Then they arose early in the morning and went up to the top of the mountain and said, here we are. We will go up to the place where the Lord has promised us what we have seen. Moses said, now why do you transgress the command of the Lord? For this will not succeed. God does not want you to go out for something that will not succeed. Do not go up lest you be defeated by your enemies, for the Lord is not among you. And the Amalekites and the Canaanites are there before you, and you shall fall by the sword, because you have turned from the Lord, and the Lord will not be with you. But they presumed to go up to the mountaintop. Nevertheless, neither the ark of covenant or of the Lord. I will not journey with where God is not going. When is the ever? I want you. Should be investment to number 15% per month. That's what everybody is discussing. You follow them. Have you noticed about you that you don't have no love for
Trust
for such thing? The day you put your money there, God is telling you your own case is different. That's what you used to say now. God said, you, I cannot allow any type of wealth to come with you. So that tomorrow when you begin to be part of the pillars of the gospel, nobody will be able to trace it to PDP or APC or crisis or armed robbery. How many of you people say, I don't want that testimony, I want money. That's all of what I'm doing.
I'm actually Torah. Torah. Why should God borrow you what is yours? Then the Amalekites and the Canaanites who dwelt in that mountain came down and attacked them and drove them fast back as former, because they went in their presumption, but God was not with them. Are we together? You shall not go out by east. The Lord will go before you. Why? Because Proverbs 13 verse 15 told me the pathway of a transgressor is hard. Out of this ground you will sweat. It's hard. The way of the unfaithful is hard. It's not life. Some of us are not dealing with life. We are dealing with folly. Some of us are not dealing with life. We are dealing with disobedience. It's hard. Life or hard. Life is challenging. That's tilling the ground. But when it's an unfaithfulness, that's toiling. Not even God can help. The Bible told me, and I showed them before Sunday, that those who love money will pierce their own soul. You know, one of the things, hardest thing, is that when they begin to tell you what you are doing is detrimental to your health, it's always a crisis. For example, they say, you can't be taking yogurt like any other. Yogurt that you have been taking since. As some people try to do fish farm.
Oh, good,
they are fish farmers, not last.
On last day.
I'm doing fish farm. Then you see goat meat. I'm doing fish farm. Then you see well garnished. People like me, I'm actually talking about myself. Last week, some people came to me and said, Pastor, in your day, I went to, I became very conscious of it. I told my wife, so to your two head. And he came out that way.
If they tell us what we are doing is hurting us, it's very hard sometimes because we have gotten used to it. It has been that there's a utility that pulling away from it can be. Told you disobedience is always not sweet. Some of us are used to being unfaithful to God. I'm beginning to see the folly of lying to God. Because the way people lie to God, they've forgotten that they are talking to God. You know, Pastor Ray used to say a statement that used to make me laugh. You know, some of you think God does not know mathematics. That's how he used to say. You think God does not know mathematics. Think God cannot calculate 10%. There's a way we do certain things and tell ourselves we have done it, forgetting we are doing it before God, who knows what is the true weight of what you are doing. You know, there's a way we just come into self-deception. Then the pathway of your faithful becomes very hard. The God you don't have beside you. What? Am I making sense? Let me try. In Acts chapter 13, verse 1 to 3, God said, separate me, Paul and Barnabas, for the work which I have called them. One of the things you are going to pray to God this morning is, show me what you have called me to do.
Yes.
See, all this, I'm doing this, and you are just wasting. You are all wasting time. I make bold, this is a week of anniversary. I've been in ministry I've preached the gospel for 23 years. I've been a full-time minister for 14 years. Let me tell you the truth. I've never paid. And I don't have partner. I can tell you with all boldness, in this church, only one person gives me money every month. Only one person. Get to calculate, I'll tell you, I'll never accept 10. That's what a great truth is. Keep living your illusion. Is it like? So listen, but the yoke is easy. Do you know what? I didn't go into ministry because people are going there. Then there's a way people just say, ah, when we're in part two, it's that book here, but you remember. There was a time Jesus Chapel sent out form for pastors. He said they wanted to recruit pastors. So one of my friends in school called me. He expected I was going to be the first person that would buy the form. Because everything about me was ministry. Then one of our friends looked at me and said, you don't understand what it means to be a pastor. People will be honoring you. Then people will be giving to you. I love. If you think people will be giving to you is the reason why God is calling you. People will give to you. People. Human beings, nothing goes for nothing.
And they are doing something many times, they are using the other eye to look at another thing.
Are they even given to themselves? Do you know that people have been led to ministry by such false? Years ago, it was anniversary. When I was in part two, one day, I was so overwhelmed with a burden to preach, and I knew that I had no future outside of the call of God. But it was a fearful realization, because nobody preaches in my family. You don't even go to a church that is Bible. When you go to the Catholic church, you don't take Bible alone. But they would have printed what you want to read, including Second Ezra, Book of
Baruch.
And all those Maccabees, that's what we read. I didn't know those books were not even in the Bible, in our own canonized Bible. I still have them on my, I still have versions of them. So, which mouth will I use to tell my father that God called me? I was here. And I went to the pastor. I said, Pastor, the way this thing is working, it's as if this ministry, and it's as if we are going through. I said, yes. It's God. I said, it's God. I was getting the encouragement. Then he said to me, he said, just finish. Make sure you finish. That was his whole body. Because he was looking at me, this guy will run after school one day. He said, just make sure you finish. He said, when you are finished, he said, we'll set you up, push you with some levels of comfort. And as I was going, God spoke to me. God said, will you do what I say you should do? Because I say you should do it. Even that comfort, God broke it. God said, look at me. I did not understand the import of that word until 7 years now. If I was waiting for pastor to push me to ministry, I will be. This church will never have existed. You want to find rest? Follow God with every singleness of mind. Draw your leadership from Him. That's what it means to be a Christian. Because the Bible told us in Romans 8:14 that as many that are led by the Spirit of God, they are what? The sons of God. Someone say, I'm led.
Amen.
In Proverbs 3, verse 5 and 6, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge Him, and He will direct your path. He will direct your path. Why? Because in Proverbs 16 verse 9, the Bible says, it is a man's heart that plans his way, but the Lord
that direct his steps.
This is the word God brought to us as we were stepping into 2020. That a man's heart plans his way. Most of our plans are falling aside today. They are falling off in the midst of the crisis and the pandemic that have happened in the world today. Because most of them are not there. And most of us are frustrated that God is asking you, who gave you the body? You gave it to yourself. So that's what Proverbs chapter 16 verse 25 told us again. Proverbs 16 verse 25. There's a way that seems right to a man, but his end is the way of death. Somebody say, Father, deliver me from the way of death. In Proverbs 19 verse 21, he said the same thing. Proverbs 19, 21. There are many plans in the heart of a man's heart. Nevertheless, the Lord's counsel, that will stand. Somebody say, your counsel for me, O Lord, will stand in the name of Jesus Christ. The easiest life to live is the life God has planted and he called you into. So you must continue in what you have learned and you have been assured of. I'm assured that God heals people.
Yes.
What did I say? God heals people. That we are not left to ourselves to find our path in life. I remember, brother, you will remember, when you were to come into Ibadan, that day you met, what is his name? The chairman, Adenuga. He told you to your face that he's taking you to a way. You remember? He said, yeah, I did. I'm already called me and said, hey, Pastor, I feel God wants me to come to you. He didn't know, how do you meet my Adenuga? And he's telling you you are going to a way. He said, feeling me. That's why some people have gone on the outside of God's plan for 25 years. They are just coming back. And I said, if that's what you believe, we pray. Then they called him and gave him the appointment and sent him to Ibadan. They sent him to the place I was in Akobo. They sent him to Uru. It was, I mean, what life can be better? He did this life. Doesn't know anybody in the system. Some people say, press it, but press it, but it. Tell it to a bad hand. I'm pressing button. I'm pressing today. You know, I'm pressing. I know people in the system. It's the counsel of the Lord that was there. May we become a people that are so susceptible to God's plan. That's where you will find rest. That is, I want somebody tall, I want somebody short, somebody must be fat, he must be walking, he must have a car. I was thinking earlier this morning that it was true when I was dating my wife, when we were dating, I didn't have a car. The medicine did not have shape, I don't even understand what she's up.
Mamma.
No, don't be serious. I didn't have a car. Now it looks like I've never lived without a car before. But I can have one car in this house. Yeah, I used to tell the guy I cannot use one car again. There must be another car. Then he just came back to me. There was a time he did. And I was just living in this town. To preach, Paul said, Bible, you must be having pilot car here. What's your problem? What's your problem? Which pilot car again? It's amazing. And can I tell you something? I don't even know how I arrived here. I was just wondering. It's not that I sat there or do it by, because I'm bigger than the church. You know, some pastors calculate on people.
I'm down there, you know, maybe.
About
15 million.
Yeah, pie. They'll just tell you, we are willing, but the flesh is weak. What do you want to do to somebody that is willing whose flesh is weak? Exodus 25, 14. We are true. Exodus 25, verse 14. See that you make them, God was speaking to Moses and to Isaiah, see that you make them according to the pattern which was shown you on the mountain. God was speaking about the tabernacle. And God took Moses to the mountain and showed him the tabernacle. There was no physical representation of it, but God showed him. Now the reason why God showed him, it means the tabernacle had already existed in heaven. The heart is only a copy. That's what Hebrews said in Hebrews 8. He said he made tabernacle, physical tabernacle, which was a copy and a shadow. What you are trying to do here is a copy. And when you want to make a photocopy, you must have a very beautiful, very clear original copy. But do you know something? The original copy is in heaven. It's in the spirit. It is shown. It is the photocopy that is. Let's read it. Read Hebrews 8. Let's read that Hebrews 8. I used to tell you people that in the spirit, a shadow is anything you can touch. Because anything you can touch, we fade. We go. These things are not real. They are shadows. What is real that does not fade is something that is not subjected to this form of tangibility. Look at it. Go back to verse. Now this is the main point of this. We are saying we have such a high priest. We sit at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heaven. Somebody say, I have an high priest. And it's in heaven. That means there's a part of my life that is not here. That's what I'm telling you. There's a dimension of our life that is not in the realm of the natural. Your high priest is not in heaven. He's a minister of the truth of the sanctuary, the true tabernacle, which the Lord erected, not man. For every high priest is appointed to offer gifts and sacrifices. Therefore, it is necessary that this one also have something to offer. For if you are not, that Jesus will not be a priest, since the priest will offer gifts according to the law. Verse 5. Who served the copy and shadow of the heavenly things? As Moses was divinely instructed when he was about to make the tabernacle, for he said, see that you make all things according to the pattern shown you on the mountain. So the pattern was shown. That means that the true tabernacle is in heaven. What you see on that is a shadow. It's a copy. That is why it is said, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. But have you waited enough to even see what is in heaven? You have went, you have gone out by haste. What is in heaven? What is in God's mind? Are you late? Are you following me? To later discover that what you are holding on to is a shadow. For this present earth and heaven will fly away from his sight, and there will be no place found for them. They are not eternal. They are shadows. Thy will be done on earth as it has been done in heaven. But to get what is in the heart of heaven, look for the garden God has planted. And stop toying with your own ideas. You don't need to do 10 different businesses. Do you discover that by the time you should strike the right business, you are spent? Because you have failed in 9. And all the end, I say, you are already in your seat. You are spent. And what spent you many a times is that you put your hands in what you are not sent to do. But don't worry, that's no problem. Today we are recovered. Like I ended in the first service, Jesus stepped into the boat of Peter and said to him, I want to use your boat to preach, and he preached from the place. And he became the first user. Then after that, he now put that, he said, turn, let down your net for a catch. And the man said, we have toiled all night and caught nothing. That's what the enemy likes for people to do. So that you keep living, you keep striving, but nothing will come out of it. Because it's not the will of God. But you know what Peter said? He said, we have done that all night and caught nothing. But at your word, we changed leadership. We used to be the one leading ourselves. But now it's not going to be your word. He said, I will do it. And when he did it, it caused substance. It's time to live at his word. Stand to your feet. I just want God to deliver us from the yoke of oppression. It's time to remember your maker. It's time to remember the one who called you out. What you are afraid of should not make you forget that there is a designer, there is somebody that designed this thing. There is somebody that designed this journey. Let's pray with Isaiah 51. Isaiah 51, verse 12 and 13. Verse 12 to 14. Maybe I just told you verse 14. I, even I, am he who comforts you. Someone said the Lord will comfort me. I'm not hearing you. You know the name Noah means God's comfort. It was through the one that God said, I will no longer curse the ground. You need to come to comfort. That's a person that made that God bless and said, labor will begin to have meaning. I'm the one who comforts you. Why are you? Who are you that you should be afraid of a man who will die and of the son of man who will be made like the grass? Verse 13 says, and you forget the Lord your maker. In the name of our fear, what do we disconnect from? The first thing that suffers is the one who is designed. We forget the maker because of our fears. They complicate the fears. You forget your maker, who spread the heaven, who laid the foundation of the earth. You fear continually every day because of the fury of the oppressor. When he has prepared to destroy, and God said, where is the fury of the oppressor? What you are even afraid of, I'm asking, where is it? I can't see it. Verse 14. The captive exile hastens that he may be loosed, that he should not die in the pit, that his bread should not fail. Is that not what we are all chasing? I must not, because if I'm in the pit, if I stay in the pit too long, and when I get thirsty, I won't have water. My bread must not fail. My water must not fail. I can bring you the news of Joseph. He never delivered himself out of the pit. Some people condemned him there, but God planted another thought. He said, why should we let him die? Is it not better to sell him? And somebody else to plan, put him in there. Some people, Reuben put him there, not because he wanted him to die, but so what? Restore back to the father. God intercepted two thoughts. The thoughts of the brothers in the Israel and the thought, because God's plan overwhelmed everything. He sent a man ahead of them. He saw what Reuben was saying. He made sure Reuben was not there when he was selling him. He saw what the brothers were thinking. He changed their thought. He said, his death is not his aim. It's not in your hand. He said, preserve. Lord, lead me to the work for which you have called me. That's the prayer. Separate me, Paul and Barnabas, for the work that I have called them. Let me find the work that you have called me to do. That's where you will find your rest. The Bible says you should ask for it. Ask for the way to Zion. Don't assume. Ask. And the Lord will lead you. Ask. Ask. the way to Zion, so that you can find rest for your soul. It's in your plan that my soul will find rest. If you are living in disobedience, please, this is the morning of repentance. The pathway of a transgressor is hard. Anything God has been calling your attention to, please just surrender it to Him. Ease your own journey. Make it easy. Stop struggling with it. Stop struggling. I just want to honor you. That let that be your prayer. I just want to honor you. I just want to honor you. That's all I want. That's all I want. That's all I want. Thank you, Jesus. It is my desire to honor you, Lord, with all my heart. I worship you.
I give you praise with me. I give you praise.
morning to find rest. Come unto me, all you who are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. I want you to talk to God. If you have lived in disobedience, I want you to just say, these are my fears. These are the things that took me away. I release them to you. I want you to lift some yoke from your own shoulder. I want you to ask for mercy this morning. I want you to ask for mercy. You must leave this meeting light. You must leave this meeting light. You must feel eased. You are not the transgressor. You must sense ease. It destroys yokes. It's not going to be hard for me to move from state to state and transit to the next phase of my life because I obey your voice. The Bible said the commandments of the Lord are not grievous. They are not grievous. So my life is not a life of grief. I'm not living a life of grief. I'm not living a life of grief. Transacting the spirit. Drop some yoke this morning. Drop some burdens. Drop some bodies. Yeraboko Shatana. Drop some bodies. Rebo Sekaroba Katada Bobodia. Until the Lord Himself has His way in your life. Drop some bodies now. Drop some bodies. Rabba Shata Rabba Katoriba Totogama. Rabba Baba Katoga Rabba Shekiniba. Thank you, Lord.